Welcome to Glasgow City Church Life. I hope you're having a blessed week. Here are this week's announcements. If you wish to take part in any of the following activities, the relevant contact details will be available on screen. Attending church services. We are delighted to say that due to the easing of COVID-19 restrictions on public worship, it is no longer necessary to pre-register online for attendance at Glasgow City Church Sunday morning gathered worship. If you are COVID positive or displaying any symptoms associated with the virus, we ask you to delay your attendance until a later period when you are free of any of the symptoms of COVID-19. Please also be aware that you will be required to register your name and contact details on entry to the building for track and trace purposes. We are also delighted to say that Glasgow City Church no longer has a number restriction, and also that during worship, the congregation is now allowed to sing. However, basic COVID hygiene requirements are still in place. Please remember to use the hand sanitizers provided and to wear a mask unless exempt while in the building. Anything else you need to know will be communicated in the service, although it is up to each individual to decide when they are ready to return to gathered church. We do so look forward to seeing you when that time comes. God bless you. You can still join our live streams on ChurchOnline and YouTube, where the videos are available at your convenience. You can also communicate with others using the interactive tools the platforms provide. There is an online Sunday school shortly after the service. It starts at 12:15 p.m. Your little ones can spend time together on Zoom with a teacher who will take them through a lesson based on the Bible. JAM is our teen group. JAM stands for Jesus and Me. And they meet on Zoom on Sundays at 12:45 p.m. each week. If you're a young person aged between 13 to 18 years old, you're invited to join in. Join us for prayer on Zoom on Wednesdays and for international prayer on Saturdays at 8 a.m. to 8:30 a.m., as well as prayer before our Sunday service at 10 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. Reach is a group of young adults interested in studying the Bible together. They have a Wednesday meeting at 7:30 p.m., as well as other social events spread throughout the year. Calling all worshippers, join us on Friday, 20th of August, 2021 for a night of praise and worship at GCC from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. Let's come together as one to worship our Lord Jesus Christ. Hope to see you there. Pastoral care groups are available to keep you connected. A person will be allocated to call you regularly to keep you informed with online church activities, pray with you, and help you with anything you might need. The audiovisual team is looking for new members to volunteer. Do you have an interest in the audiovisual aspect of church service? Please get in touch to find out how you can help. Street Connect are looking for new volunteers, particularly male volunteers in their mission of outreach. If you would like to volunteer or help in any way, visit their website at www.streetconnect.co.uk or contact the number on screen. If you'd like to give an offering to Glasgow City Church, please take a note of the details on the screen now. You can either take a photo on your phone or take a screenshot with the device you're currently using to watch this service. If you pay taxes, please remember to gift aid your giving, as it will increase your giving by 25% at no extra charge to yourself. If you'd like to donate using PayPal, you can donate using the donate link on the Glasgow City Church website. We thank you for your generosity. For anything else you might need, please visit our website, YouTube channel, or Facebook page as seen on the screen now. Thank you for listening, and I pray you join us for an online event during the week. God bless.
So there's been a bit more consistency in the past month in terms of volunteers. There's been even slightly more numbers of volunteers. We've been able to connect with a lot of different people in the streets and in the cafe as well. Another really important thing is having a time each week on the Saturday night for somebody to be able to just share a very brief testimony or a word in the cafe. So we've been, you know, we always did that in the past, and as we've reopened the drop-in, we've been thinking about trying to make that a consistent thing again every week. So it's something that we don't want to neglect, because we want to tell people about Jesus, about what he's done for all of us, and it's a really important thing. So we're making sure to try and do that again every week. And I would say, you know, if there's anybody who maybe has a testimony that they would like to share, that they think could have an impact on people, then maybe let me know and we could discuss it. Maybe something you would like to do. So now I'm going to pass on to Fiona Donaldson, who's going to share a wee bit about an idea within Street Connect that's being considered, being prayed about. So I'll pass on to her now to tell you about that.
Good morning. I've been asked to tell you about a new venture being considered by Street Connect for the women. The problem with women in addiction is that they often have children. And because of the addiction, the children don't sometimes have their needs met and they can end up being accommodated. That's a problem because the women are then trying to get their children back in the stressful situation which has contributed to their addiction, or they need to go away to rehab. That's a year. It means giving up your house, contact implications for the children, and the clock continues to tick for the planning for the children. So this is something Julie's had in her heart for a number of years. And it is to have a facility that women can come to for a period of 3 months to break their pattern of addiction, where they can still have contact with their children, where they're surrounded by loving care and teaching. And of course, our goal is not just rehabilitation, but transformation. Now, there's a lot to do, a lot of preparation to be made, and looking at staff and programs and women facilities. So we want to invite you to join us in prayer for this. Pray at home or join us on a Monday morning at 9:15 online. Please speak to either Lorraine or myself if you would like to do so. We'd be really happy to have you join us. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Today we are looking at our series on encounters, and I'll be looking at the encounter of Paul with the Lord, as detailed in Acts chapter 9. We'll be reading the first 9 verses of Acts chapter 9, and then I will take my subject matter following on from there. And I'm reading from the King James Version of Acts chapter 9, verse 1 to 9. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. And he desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of the way, whether they be men or women, he might bring them unto Jerusalem bound. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined around him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you persecute. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what you must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was there 3 days without sight, and neither did he eat nor drink. The Lord add his blessing to his words. Amen. Amen. In this series of encounters, we've been looking at various people who encountered the Lord. And today we're looking at Paul's encounter, which we've just narrated. The things that I want to bring out is that Paul, as he became known latterly, set himself against God and against his anointed. But little did he realize that God was already waiting for him as well on the way to Damascus. He said Paul went to the head of the synagogue. He collected warrants to go and round up all the Christians. But God, who has every knowledge and who's omnipotent and omniscient, was well ahead of Paul. So he encountered him on the way to Damascus. And so he says, suddenly, I like the suddenly of God. He says, as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shone round about him a light from heaven. And Paul immediately realized that this is no ordinary moment, because the first question he said is, Who art thou, Lord? Now you have to pause there and ask yourself the question. How did Saul of Tarsus, how did he know that the person that is speaking to him was the Lord? And the Lord replied to him and said, It is I that you are persecuting. I am Jesus Christ. Now, if you look at the old scenario, Saul was on his way to cause mayhem for Christians. But Christ was also on his way to put obstacles in Paul's way, so that what he intended for evil would be turned to good. And I want to stop here and place it squarely and fairly that God has our backs. He makes everything perfect and beautiful at all times. So, Saul got into that state where he was blind, could not see, could not eat, and he was led to Damascus by the men around him. When he got to Damascus, there enters another key person. His name is Ananias. And if you were Ananias, you'd be really, really, really worried. Because when the Lord revealed himself to Ananias, that Ananias was to go to a street called Straight to speak to a man called Saul of Tarsus. Ananias said, Lord, you cannot be serious. I have heard of him. He's the one that is going around killing every Christian, and you're saying to me, I've got to go and speak to him. But the Lord reassured Ananias and said, I know so. I know he's notorious for killing Christians or the people of the way, but I still want you to go and speak to him. And so Ananias plucked up courage, and he went. And he got to verse 13, it says, Then Ananias answered the Lord, I have heard by many of these men how much evil he had done to the saints at Jerusalem. But he went. And in 17, it says, Ananias went his way and entered into the house, putting his hands onto Paul and said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, has appeared unto thee in the way as thou came here and sent me, that thou should receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let me just pause for a moment there. Sometimes we are all like Ananias. We see someone that we think is beyond redemption because of what we know about them. But the Lord says there's no one beyond redemption. Saul was not beyond redemption. Yes, it killed many Christians. It had been there even when Stephen was being murdered. He was the one gathering all the cloaks. He was a cloaks man. He was collecting the cloaks so that he can have a free throw of the stone to kill Stephen. But here the Lord says, I have need of him. I have a job for him to do. And so Ananias did as the Lord asked him to do, and indeed, Saul received the sight. And what did Saul do immediately he received the sight? Verse 19 says, When he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then Saul sat in days with the disciples, which were Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogue, that Christ is the Son of God. But all that heard them were amazed and said, It's not these, the one that destroyed them, which called on the name of the Lord in Jerusalem. For he might bring them bound unto the chief priests.
But Saul increased more his strength and confounded the Jews which dwelt in Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. Now, following through from where he started to where the Lord has brought him, he is now the one proclaiming the gospel. He's not the one saying, this Jesus Christ is the real deal. It's the one for whom people are now afraid, because once he used to persecute them. Now he's a disciple and they don't know how to relate to him. But nonetheless, Paul had a genuine encounter with the Lord. And some of the proof of that encounter is what he's currently doing. In fact, the people became a little bit worried. They wanted to kill him because they're not sure if it was a counterfeit. But God, in his mercy, sent again Barnabas. In verse 27, Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and how he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. And so, Saul has moved from a person of hate to a person of love by the virtue of his encounter with the Lord. And he is now the one proclaiming the gospel, the one calling people to the way of the Lord. Now, if you said to anyone, Saul will one day serve the Lord, people will say, no, you've got to be joking. Did you not know what he did? Did you not see what he did? Did you not hear where he went? But God had an interest, and has always had an interest in everyone. To those who yield themselves to the Lord makes a way. And so Saul now became the preacher of the gospel with fervor and with strength. And because Saul, who used to persecute the Christians, has now come to know the Lord, listen to verse 31 of the example of this chapter 9. Then had the churches rest throughout all Judea, Galilee, Samaria, and were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord, and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, and were multiplying. Because Saul encountered the Lord, peace reigned in Jerusalem, in Judea, and all the places where Christians were once persecuted. The gospel had a free reign. And this is an encounter that you could not have predicted if you were sitting and trying to predict what the future would look like. You couldn't have. But the Lord has a way and means to encounter it in every one of us. So he encountered Saul, and Saul became his disciple. He encountered him in a very unique way that Saul would not be able to defend his situation, because when Ananias went to him, it was as if a scale fell off his eyes. So who could scale him? The Lord. So that he would know for certainty that this was no ordinary encounter. Who revealed to him whom he was persecuting? The Lord. So the encounter of Saul was none other by the Lord. So, and Saul knew it, and the people around him knew it also. But now that peace and tranquility has returned to Jerusalem and to the surrounding areas, we have to hear the encounter of Saul according to his own word, to know the impact of the encounter on him. And for that, please turn with me to indeed the book of Philippians chapter 3, where indeed Paul was given an account of his conversion. And we start reading from verse 4 actually. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, this is Paul speaking, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I, the more, should have trust. Circumcised on the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew, of Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, I persecuted the church, touching the righteousness which is in me, and the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those are counted loss for Christ. Yes, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them out but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his suffering, being made comfortable unto his death. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after it, if that I may apprehend that for which also I have apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press on to the mark of the high calling in Jesus Christ. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything, be ye otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so, as you have us as an example. Amen. Now, this is Paul giving an account of his journey. But he made some statements that are very bold. But I want to start by just chronicling something. If Paul had not had an encounter with the Lord, as he did, where would we be? How would we know the rich depth of the gospel as we know it today? If Saul had not had an encounter on the way to Damascus, How would we in this speak of the Damascus Road experience? If Saul had not had his encounter, how would we know about Paul's first and second missionary journeys? If he had not been through the encounter, how would we know about the wonders and miracles that the Lord brought to pass through him? How would we know of the soul that says, my greatest desire is to know him and the power of his resurrection, to be found in him, that everything that I have gained, I count them as loss? If he had not had that encounter, would we have such insight into the fact that to want to press into for the mark of the high calling in Jesus Christ is the most important thing? This was because Saul had this encounter that we can talk about his first and second missionary journey, his Damascus Road experience, the fact that he suffered much for the Lord, but he preached much for the Lord as well. He accomplished much for the kingdom of God because of his encounter with the Lord. And my prayer, and for myself and for us that are listening today, is the fact that we all need an encounter with the Lord, because then we have a revelation of who we are and who he is. Saul saw himself as the Lord saw him. He saw himself as one persecuting the church. And he also knew who he was persecuting, though he might be persecuting the church. But the person he's persecuting is the Lord himself, because the Lord is the head of all things to the church. And so, because he had this encounter, there was a turnaround in Saul's life. There was a turnaround of great gargantuan proportion, such that we who are Christians today owe him a debt of gratitude, that he brought much of what we read as the gospel today is written by him. Is it Philippians? Is it whichever one you want to name, the letters of Paul and epistles? He wrote a sizable chunk of what we call the New Testament or the Gospels today. But if he had not had that encounter, would we have the privilege? So I go back to where I started from. We all should seek to have an encounter with the Lord. There is something about the suddenly of the Lord, when the Lord bursts into our own time and stops time dead in his track and speaks to our hearts directly. For Saul, God bursted suddenly into his track, and he became a new creation. No more in condemnation, for here in the grace of God, he indeed stands or stood when he was alive. And so, today, as you reflect on this, think about if Saul had not had all these encounters, where would we as Christians be today? Where would we be in our walk with the Lord? Where would we be in our walk of faith? Because Paul said here, brethren, follow me as I follow Christ, because he has walked closely with the Lord. So he can encourage all of us who are walking with the Lord to carry on walking with the Lord, that we should fix our eyes on the prize of the high calling in Jesus Christ, that we press in into Jesus on every day and every moment. And so this encounter that Saul had was a significant turning point for the whole of creation, literally. Not just Christians, but the whole of creation, because anyone who's registered would know that had he not had his encounter, where would he be? And where might he be? So we thank the Lord for Saul's encounter with him. We thank the Lord for all the product that came out of that encounter. And we pray that we all will seek an encounter with the Lord, one that will transform us from where we are to where God is taking us, where we'll be comfortable saying, it's no longer I that liveth, the Christ that lives in me. And the life that I now live by faith in the Lord, I live by faith through Christ, who has given me strength. So we thank God, and may the Lord add his blessing to his word. We thank God. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you for the encounter that Saul had with you. Thank you for the transformation that it brought in his life, and by product of that in our lives. Thank you for the many, many, many parts of your word that were written by Saul because of his obedience to you and because of the encounter that he had with you. Father, we seek an encounter with you on a daily basis, Lord. Encounter us in our walks with you, whether we are sitting down, whether we are walking up. Please encounter us. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen.
Rest.
and abide with us from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. We shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you all.